About in New Jersey with the women's soccer national team about to arrive at Newark Airport after they won their record fourth World Cup title over in France this weekend and their second consecutive title since the launch of the FIFA Women's World Cup, which was back in 1991. So here they come back from France, the champions. The men's team's never accomplished anything like this, despite appearing in their first men's World Cup way back in 1930. Look at this. They got the water cannons out for them and everything. That is the true hero's welcome. I get this at LaGuardia every time I land. The same thing, the red carpet, the water cannons. The women's team has also been really killing it in the ratings, too. We like to talk about numbers around here, and we had some pretty good ones earlier today. 19 million viewers watched the game on Fox yesterday, up from the Men's World Cup final last year, France versus Croatia. That was just over 11 million viewers in the United States. So with that, we're going to stay on these pictures because I'm sure we'll see the team come out of the plane here in a minute or two, or hopefully we will. Patrice Onwuka joins us. Patrice is senior policy analyst at the Independent Women's Forum. And we have you on today, Patrice, because this story's become bigger, right, than just about sports or soccer. And the fight over pay equality, even in the final yesterday in France, you had people chanting, equal pay, equal pay. What's your take on all of this in terms of what this team did for, you know, the payment of women and payment of women athletes in particular?
Well, I think what the women's team has done has been phenomenal. Number one, they came out on top, and they are number one, which is fantastic. The challenge is that they are number one in women's sports, and we understand that women's sports historically have had smaller fan bases, fewer viewers, and, you know, that's led to less revenue. Now, over the past couple of years, I think we've seen that's changing, and that could impact compensation. Right. Because, you know, as we understand, their compensation is tied to, you know, the revenue that's generated. And so, you know, when we talk about really women earning what they're worth, I think that's a better slogan than this kind of equal pay for equal work.
Right.
Because, you know, at the end of the day, a lot of us as women, we determine what we make in the choice, in how much we earn based on the choices that we make. And that's a fantastic power that we have.
Now, there's a couple of things here. Number one, their salaries, comparing them to the men's national teams, not an apples to apples comparison, because the women do get paid a salary. I believe what I read is somewhere around $250,000 a year, something like that on average. Player, it could differ just for playing soccer. With the men's team, they don't. They get paid an appearance fee, essentially, to play for the national team. Their salaries are usually paid by their club teams. But what I do find interesting, Patrice, we had the number up about prize money. And FIFA, which is the governing body of soccer, pays out prize money when you win a World Cup. Only $30 million on the women's side. The Wall Street Journal had really interesting statistics on that today. In their article, they said 1 billion people, give or take, watch the Women's World Cup around the world on television. And if you use the same ratio, people watching versus prize money, that 30 million should be for the women, not 300 where the men are, but 112 million. In other words, it should be much higher. It should be like four times that. So that seems to me to be a, you know, a fairly convincing argument. What do you think?
Well, I think it is convincing, but again, there are a lot of other factors that go into pay, and you know, the prize money I do think is a separate issue here, and it's how it's divvied out. I think there's going to be greater scrutiny now, and you know, just what happens with these prizes. But going back to the idea of compensation and pay, you know, there are a lot of other factors that come into play here, and you know, I think, Connell, what's interesting is it's reflective of the larger workforce that we have in the United States and even in other countries where the choices that we make. Particularly looking at the women's soccer team, not only do they get a salary, but they also have generous benefits, and that's what they wanted. A lot of women in the workforce today, they choose benefits, work from home, telework, medicine, over a higher pay structure, even riskier pay, like the bonus pay that men's soccer team players earn. So, you know, I think when it comes to those prizes, it's interesting, and I think you might see some changes in the future. But when it comes to the salary, there is so much that goes into how much we earn that a simple slogan like equal work for equal pay doesn't really capture it.
Right. You're right. It is a little bit more complicated than that. And it'll be interesting to see how they do on endorsements. Some of them do very well already. Like Alex Morgan, for example, is probably the team's biggest star, supposedly. Mm-hmm. Well, I read in Sports Illustrated makes over $1 million, makes in the low seven figures is what the article I saw, you know, in total compensation. So that means she makes far more endorsements than she does in salary. So let's see if some other players kind of piggyback on that. I mean, they're bigger stars, by the way. There's no doubting that.
Yeah.
They're bigger stars than the men's team. You'd be hard pressed unless you're a big fan to name four or five players on the men's team. And most people now that watch the game would know these women. Anyway, Patrice, good to see you. Thank
you
for coming on.
Good to see you, too. Thank you.